my part of all this is to look at essentially model projections and look forward. And I'm gonna focus on California, but not ignore the outside western part of North America. So precipitation in this part of the world occurs selectively, and a lot of it falls as snowpack. Snow is an extra reservoir. Mike just made that point, but it's been central to the water supply and water management strategy in our part of the world. And of course, a story that's unfolding is how that reservoir will erode as climate warms in the next several decades, which of course is a theme of this conference. This is a map that actually Mike generated. Forget about all of the details, but the colors essentially express the vulnerability of any point in the landscape to warming by way of changing the precipitation regime from snow to rain. And what you notice is how exquisitely intense the west slope of the Sierras and Cascades are, and in larger measure, the western part of the country, the mountainous west, compared to elsewhere. So we have, in this part of the world, a particular vulnerability to climate warming that affects our water resource. And Mike just went through a lot of examples of how the early signs of all this are happening. This happens to be calibrated to a temperature rise of 3 degrees Celsius, which is kind of what you might say is the median of climate projection estimated warming by the end of the present century. But that gives you an idea of what we're confronted with here. So let's look at projections, knowing at the outset that virtually every climate model driven by scenarios of greenhouse gases on into the 21st century are warming. In our part of the world, that is California southward, many of those projections are actually showing drier conditions emerging, but that's not unanimous. So there's still a lot of uncertainty there, and of course a lot of modeling work will consume us as a community with that. This is a projection, actually an ensemble of projections of temperature. This is sort of the center part of our state. This is for Sacramento. The blue part is the projections run in hindcast fashion, that is, they run retrospectively as well as prospectively. And there's a number of different scenarios here. One thing that should be pointed out, and this kind of accompanies what Mike just went through, these are all models now. These are coupled models. They're not initialized by actual conditions in the real atmosphere. But what the models think, based on the sort of forcing that Mike was mentioning, remember that sort of exponentiation that began in the 1980s with the radiative forcing. Well, that you can actually see here in the swarm of model projections. This happens to be, again, over Sacramento, expressed as an annual basis. And then, of course, going forward, as other speakers have pointed out, there's a good deal of width in this envelope over time, But even the simulations that are ones in which greenhouse gas emissions are essentially shut off, those are the so-called commitment scenarios, still have warming over today's climate, because the atmosphere, the Earth system is still equilibrating to the greenhouse gases that are depositing to that. And of course, at the higher end here, we are eclipsing 5 Celsius of warming on into the end of the century. So here's an example. This is the Sierra Nevada. San Francisco Bay Area is up here. This is the southern part of the Sierra up to the latitude of Yosemite Park and Lee Vining. A lot of you have driven 395 and gone past Mono Lake and so forth. And this is a typical July afternoon. Temperatures are shown here. It's intuitive. So what I'm going to show is a little cartoon that's developed from the GFDL climate model from the fourth assessment. This is middle century, and this end of century. So this kind of puts into color the fact that the cooler temperatures at higher elevations, of course, are being eroded or diluted, and of course the warmer isotherms are creeping uphill. This has a lot of impact on the hydrological cycle, and as well as ecosystems and so forth. So in what follows, many of the analyses that I'm going to show you are done for this entire block of how we've defined the Sierra Nevada here, which is the colored part, which are elevations above 500 meters or so. And of course, the Sierra is arranged, is kind of tilted, so that the southern part of the mountains are higher, and the northern part are a bit lower, so that a lot of our immunity to climate warming comes in the south, and the really strong response happens in the northern part of the Sierra because it's lower, not because it's north. We will use downscaled climate simulations, downscaled to about an eighth of a degree or 12 kilometers, and we will use a hydrological simulation offline, driven by these downscaled temperatures and precipitations, to explore what might happen hydrologically in this landscape. First of all, here's the warming laid out. This is 16 different GCMs, global climate models, that are downscaled, and this is now aggregated over that entire Sierra Nevada region. I've stratified these by the higher and the lower emissions scenario here, the so-called A2 and B1. This is arranged by early, middle, and latter part of the 21st century. And of course, you can see the warming proceeding. Actually, the two emission scenarios aren't too distinct until about mid-century, whereupon the accumulation of greenhouse gases starts to take over. And then you can see the great amount of warming. This happens to be for the summertime in the A2 simulation compared to the B1. Also, you note here that there's quite a bit of variability, not only between scenarios, but between climate simulations. And that, of course, is why we like to look at ensembles, because you don't trust any given model. But again, here you're seeing temperature changes that are, as was previously said, really taking us into a regime that our intuition doesn't inform anymore. So That's temperature. This is precipitation. Again, 16 of these aligned by emission scenario A2, B1, early, middle, later part of the century. Your eye is kind of sort of taken by the fact that there are actually scenarios that produce wetter conditions in the Sierras. Those are the blue ones here, and some of them quite a lot wetter. But actually, if you look at the numbers of the simulations, there's more simulations that dry than actually wetten. And the amount of drying in, if you were to simply look at the median of all this, is something in the neighborhood of 10% by the end of the century. So 10% doesn't sound like that much, but imagine these water systems that we have in the West that are nearly fully subscribed, and we're imposing 10% reductions during a climate that's yet warmer than it is today. So that could be quite significant. Of course, if these wetter models actually materialize, then that's going to help to offset the problems that we have from warming. But on the basis of just numbers, you would at least have to be prepared for simulations would get drier. Well, here's a simulation which doesn't change too much at all, and this is a simulation that by the end of the century is relatively restrained as far as the amount of warming it produces. It's the NCAR PCM simulation. This was an experiment that Noah Knowles and myself conducted a few years back, and this is the amount of snow in the Sierra Nevada and actually the coastal range in California in early, middle, latter part of the century. The color scale tells you the fraction of today's climatological snow that we have. To sort of distill this, what we find by the end of the century here, in response to approximately 2.5 degrees Celsius of warming, is a reduction of springtime snowpack. Springtime is when the zenith of climatological snow happens across most of the West. Is reduced to less than 50% of today's levels, and the color shading is kind of intuitive. Again, you notice the northern part of the Sierra experiencing more loss than the high southern part of the Sierra. We really erode the fringes, the lower elevation part of the range. So let's now look at this from a multi-model perspective, where we're lumping all of the Sierra together here, and we're looking at this historically as well as forward in time. And this happens to be with six climate models looking forward, and what you can see, of course, is the downward trend in the amount of snow that we have here. And these numbers are actually meaningful, where in historical terms, a relatively normal winter would be to have, on average, over this entire block, approximately 30 centimeters of water content on April 1st. And of course, you can change that number by changing the elevation over which you actually look here. But by the end of the century, we are down by probably threefold or a third to a third of that number. So I want to explore that in just a little more detail. We have color-coded the amount of snowpack, where yellow-brown is the lowest, and blue is the highest here. And I'm going to go back to, this is climatology, so this is how this hydrological model sees the whole Sierra over time, and we're laying out, in this case, 32 simulations, 16 models, two different emission scenarios, 30 and over 30, a 30-year period. So we have quite a large number of cases to look at here. Less than a third of them fall into this very low snow compartment here on the edge. And I just because for the sake of time, let's just focus on that one and look at what happens over the course of the present century. So you can see this being enriched at the expense of the higher snow part of the distribution more and more. And by the end of the century, as opposed to less than 30% of the cases here, now we have more than 50% of years in which the spring snowpack is in that, I would call it quite a critically low category. Now, as Mike pointed out, this doesn't mean we lose water. What it means is that we lose snow as a reservoir. There was water in the system, it just did not accumulate as snow. It looked at in a slightly different point. Now the same color coding holds here. We've represented the snow by colors, and as we've made the color dots inversely proportional to the amount of springtime snow. So this is that laid out historically, and you can see that historically this is the range of temperatures, which is one axis on this plot. Precipitation over the whole Sierra is the other one. Notice that we get an interesting distribution of snow water equivalent that actually ranges by about a tenfold from the very lowest to the very highest between 1 year and the next over all of these 30 years of simulations, 32 different climate models. Here's now stepping forward into the early part of the present century, you can see that the distribution shifts to the right, that is, it's getting warmer. And you can also notice that the number and also the size of these dots is increasing. The size of the dots are increasing because the snow is getting less. So we've done that in inverse proportion with a radius. This is the middle part of the century, warmer still, and end of century, really warm. And notice the lack of blue dots on here, the lack of high snow cases. So we are losing the part of our hydroclimate that is the magnificently high snow year in the Sierra, where you see the springtime snowpack as you drive up the 395. The other thing to notice is that as we push the climate to the warm side of the dial, the number or the intensity and incidence of these brown dots pushes farther and farther up the precipitation scale. So what that means is that the effect of temperature, the effect of warming, is starting to override the effect of relatively ample precipitation. The warming climate is sufficient to erode the snowpack, even though we have a fair bit of precipitation. So this is every year plotted together on a precipitation increasing this way, temperature actually increasing to the left, And this is the snowpack here. So you can see the amount of snow in any given spring. And the effect on the Sierra snowpack kind of parametrically as we turn these dials in temperature and precipitation as prescribed by these climate simulations that were conducted in by the IPCC exercise in the fourth assessment. So the other thing to notice here is how this curve starts to steepen in its changes and the incidence of low snow as you get into this territory of warmer temperatures. Okay, so one other look at this. So far we've looked at springtime snow, that is the April 1st snowpack. The snow surveyors that Mike mentioned go out roughly the first of every month and weigh the snow in the western mountains, and that's often why we use April 1st. But now in this case, what we're doing is we're looking at snow, again from the vantage point of the hydrologic model, across the season. So this is November, January, February, March. April 1st in today's climate is close to the maximum, and then of course there's this recession of snow as springtime sets in and summer and insolation takes over. But so this is what we can view as climatology. Now we're going to step through decades down the page, and we'll look at this through the 21st century. The median of the historical snow is shown by this dot, and so what I want to call your attention to is how the entire seasonal envelope of snow is declining, and particularly the edges of the snow. The other thing that's changing, much in concert with what Mike mentioned, is that there's a timing issue here, whereas the timing of our maximum snow is no longer going to be on April 1st. It's going to be pushed back earlier in spring as the as warming and associated effects take over. So here's 2050 through 2059. Finally the last decade of the century. So you can see now that it looks to me like the maximum snow is now in February instead of late March and April, and of course the amount of the snowpack has really declined a lot. So now getting to the runoff issue, which Mike covered, he talked about it in terms of a change in 2 weeks. I'm showing you actually a different metric. This is the fraction of annual runoff that occurs in wintertime and in spring and early summer. Wintertime, January through March. So we take the January through March flow volume as a ratio of the total annual flow. And we do likewise with April through June, when in today's world, a lot of our high elevation streams are actually producing most of their runoff then. The changes that we're seeing here are expressed in as a fraction, and the fractions start to get colorful when we reach about 15% plus or minus relative to their historical value. So what you see over time is this winter fraction of flow increasing, and this is the period where Mike said this was bad. That's because we're getting water coming off during a period when there's still storms, and when our reservoirs, which remember are not only water saving vessels, they're also flood protection, we have to leave a reservation space for the next big pulse. So having all this increasing runoff in winter, and of course, if you increase it in winter, you you rob it from the spring and summer. As a society and as a, you know, as a water resource profession, this is a big, big challenge that's coming down the tracks. We've had an early look at the floodiness from these models, which is shown here in the northern and the southern part of the Sierra Nevada, and that is shown here as the change in amplitude in the 50-year flood. I won't go through all of the details, but the short end of the story is that both the B1 and the A2 simulations are showing significant changes in flood flows as time goes on, as snow lines get higher, as we're essentially draining larger fractions of our watersheds with a given storm over time. Finally, what is happening is that when we look at the state of the hydrology, essentially what's left after the wintertime, this is the June soil moisture, and these changes are red being drying and blue being wetting, we can see that a large part of this southwestern landscape, including California, is going to get drier because we've essentially run off earlier with the warming climate, and of course the warming itself is causing more ET and the like. So we have a system that has large variability, that the climate that we live in California is amongst the most variable across the United States, and we're driving it with more stress as climate warms in the future. It looks like the changes that are going to be imposed by temperature warming in the future are going to start rivaling the changes in the snowpack system that are today caused by fluctuations in precipitation. So it's going to be a new world in the future, and we're going to see the snow loss starting early on in the season and essentially continuing through the winter and on into the spring, with the associated effects in the summer hydrology. That's it.